She remembered reading somewhere a passage from a book which she could no longer trace. Words which had struck her at the time and which she now tried to reconstruct. Inscribed on the lid of the box were the words, "Anatomy is no longer destiny." And inside, when she opened it, she found the figure of the Greek Sphinx with full breasts and feathery wings. She lifted it up out of the box to look at it more closely. As she did so, it seemed to her that its lips moved and it spoke a few phrases in a language which she could not understand, except for three words which were repeated several times. Capital, delay, and body. She replaced it in the box and closed the lid. She could feel her heart beat. The rhythm of the sentences was not quite right, and she felt sure there was some particular she had forgotten. She tried to imagine the scene as the writer might have. Would the box have been padded with cushioning? A quilted material? Folds of velvet? Black or red? Buttoned or embroidered? What would the pattern of the embroidery be? She imagined an intricate web of curved forms, intertwined knots, like the tendrils and fronds in the marsh where, according to Bakoven, the first matriarchy arose. Or the curls of pubic hair from which, according to Freud, women wove the first veil. What kind of material was the Sphinx carved from? Soft like wax or hard like agate? Ancient like amber or more modern like bakelite? Were the feathers real, rippling under her heedful touch like overlapping waves? Whatever it was that she'd forgotten, it was surely something more central, more weighty, not some detail of design or manufacture. Could she have known the name of the language which the Sphinx spoke? The more she tried to remember, the more she found her mind wandering, mislaying the thread of logical reconstruction, and returning to images from her own childhood. She remembered how, when she'd been very small, her mother had lifted her up to carry her on her hip, and how she'd hovered round her cot while she fell asleep. She remembered her feeling of triumph when her father left the house, and the sudden presentiment of separation which followed. There was the time when she'd opened a drawer with a little key and found a piece of coral and a badge which had gone darkish green. And she remembered one morning coming into her mother's room and finding her mother's friend sleeping next to her mother. And she suddenly understood something she realized her mother had tried to explain, and she felt a surge of panic, as though she'd been left behind and lost. She thought her mother would be angry, but she smiled. And when she got out of bed, she noticed the shapes of the arch of her foot and her heel and the back of her calf. She'd been drawing acrobats, trajectories of the body and displays of skill and balance. She saw them no longer as pioneers of the ideal, but as bodies at work, expending their labour power upon its own material. She was fascinated by the gap between the feeling of bodily exertion and the task of drawing and writing, gestures which consume themselves in their own product, giving a false sense of effortlessness, which no acrobat could hope to approach. Capital, delay, and body. She replaced it in the box and closed the lid. She could feel her heart beat. she felt giddy with success, as though after laboring daily to prevent a relapse into her pristine humanity, she had finally got what she wanted. She shuddered. Suddenly, she heard a voice, very quiet, coming from the box. The voice of the Sphinx, growing louder, till she could hear it clearly, compellingly, and she knew that it had never ever been entirely silent, and that she had heard it before, all her life, since she first understood that she was a girl. The voice was so familiar, yet so fatally easy to forget. She smiled and, in her mind, she flung herself through the air.